Good morning. Morning. Let me just congratulate you. That just went quiet at exactly the right time. Perfect. Well, most of us went quiet at the right time, didn't we? If you're watching online, welcome. It's great to have you with us. If you're in the room, even better. If you're in the room for the first time or for the first time in a long time, then a special welcome to you. That's fantastic. I was just looking around and thinking, what a good-looking bunch of people. Anyway, let me pray, and then we're going to stand and we're going to sing together. Father God, we thank you that we have a privilege, and that privilege is just being able to meet together with like-minded people, with people that just come to praise you, just come to pour out our love for you, or people who are just looking, seeking, just want to find something about the truth. And so I pray today, Lord God, that you will just somehow be in this place. You'll be in amongst all our songs. You'll be in amongst the words that Matt says. You'll be in amongst our conversations. And make yourselves real to us in Jesus' name. Thank you for that amen from the back there. Lovely. Well done, Kyle. Shall we stand and sing together?
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil what we were made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church, we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first, we hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive's heart released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church, and we pray revive this earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty changing hearts. You made us for much more than this. Awake the kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. We are your church, and we are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom. Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you.
Fantastic. Would you like to take your seats? We're just going to pray for a minute or two before we invite Matt up to join with us. It's difficult. I think it's difficult to get to grips with where we are in the country at the moment. I kind of stopped watching the news over the last few days because you kind of get sucked into the news. So I think Rishi Sunak has been Prime Minister for less than a week. Is that right? Or is it more than a week? You kind of lose track very, very quickly. But one of the things that as believers in Christ, we're told to pray for our government. And that's been really difficult, I think, at times over the last little while, just to know what to pray. But we are instructed to pray. And so we're just going to pray for those who are in charge of leading this country right now. So shall we bow our heads? Father, it's difficult sometimes to know what to pray. We look at some of the things that have happened of late and we despair. And yet you command us to pray for those who take charge. And so we're going to do that today, Lord God. And we're going to do that in dependence of you, that you would take charge and that you would ensure that the right things happen for this world. So, Father God, we pray for those right at the top of the tree in government today, this week. Would you give them, above all else, integrity and wisdom to do the job that they've been called to do and to do it well? Lord, we know it's not easy, and we whinge and we complain about decisions that are made. And it's a tough situation, we get that. But we just pray for that integrity and wisdom in our leaders. Father God, for those who follow you in government, help them to be strong in their beliefs and the way they do things as well. Father, we just want to leave those things to you in the hope that you will act and make this world a better place. In Jesus' name. Amen. If this is your first time or you haven't been for quite a while, you're in for a real treat. I'm just going to build up Matt just to put the pressure on him. Matt, do you want to come?
Thank you. I'm not sure many people would count me as a real treat, but thank you.
We would. We would, wouldn't we? Absolutely. Matt, before you get started, we kind of last time we did this 14 questions.
Yes.
You still hold the record for the best answer ever.
Oh.
For those who are in here, one of the questions was, what is the worst sound? And Matt's answer was, the worst sound is when somebody says, when you get to McDonald's and they say, we've just run out of.
It's true. I still rate big McDonald's breakfasts as quite high up on the scale. I quite like a McDonald's breakfast.
Fine,
so.
There you go. Yeah. But what we maybe know a bit little less about that is what you do for a living. So I wonder if you could...
Okay, potted... Yeah, of course I can. Yeah, no worries. So my name's Matt Levett, and I've worked really all my life as a youth worker. I left school... When I left school, without any... GCSEs or A levels or anything, and I started working as a lifeguard in the leisure centre. And long story short, I met this girl. She took me to church, and I became a Christian. And I sort of did this deal with God. I don't know if you can do this, but I did. I made this deal with God, and I said, God, I don't know if you're real, but I believe in Jesus, and I want to spend my life telling young people about Jesus. And in His grace, He's allowed me to do that. And so, for all of my working career, I've spent my time working for churches as a youth worker. Until about 3 years ago, I changed my job, and I now work for the Anglican Church, which is this beautiful, dynamic, faith-filled, very, very strange organisation. Okay? And so I work for the Anglican Church, which is, if you don't know, it's all those traditional old church buildings in every village across the country. Which actually is one of its strengths. There's a presence every corner you turn round. But I work for what they call the diocese, which is basically Suffolk, right across Suffolk. And I go to all these little churches and I try and help them and encourage them and inspire them, particularly when it comes to thinking about young people. Because if we want our churches to grow, we have to think about something very, very different. Not changing the message, but perhaps change how we do it. Because the truth is, I mean, I could talk for hours on this, but the truth is, the generations that are coming up, Generation Z, and the ones even younger, which are Generation Alpha, they're pre-Christian. They're not post-Christian. It's not that they've considered Christianity and decided against it. They're in a pre-Christian phase. They don't know the Bible stories that for many of us, we learn at Sunday school and we keep hearing. They don't know any of that. They don't know who Jesus is, apart from as a swear word. They don't know about the concept of God. So it's not that they've become atheists. It's that they just don't have enough information to make an informed decision. But most of our churches, if I'm honest, most of our churches are set up for people who already know a lot of stuff about God. And so my job is to help challenge churches and to encourage them, inspire them. Most Friday night sees me at some little tiny youth club somewhere around Suffolk helping out, which is fantastic. We've got about 450 odd churches, depending on how you count them, about 450 churches and under 500 young people in those churches. So we've got a task on our hand, but I believe in the church. I believe in who you are and who I am and who we are as the people of God. So that's what I do. I could keep talking if you want me to keep talking, but maybe I can come another time and talk about culture and what's happening in the lives of our young people. But I remember a few instances just before I start, a few moments that stick with me. I remember taking a young person to church who'd never been to church before, and we went through the whole service. And I turned to him at the end and I said, just out of interest, why didn't you take communion? And they went, oh, I didn't pay. Because we'd sent round the offering basket beforehand. And because nobody had explained what the offering basket really was, they connected the offering basket to communion. And for those of you that do know something about faith, the phrase, I didn't pay, when it comes to communion, actually gets you right here. I'd taken another young person to church, and the vicar did nothing wrong, and he just said, hey, we're going to have a reading from James. And this young person turned to me and said, who's James, and why is he reading to us? Because he didn't know there was a book in the Bible called James. And I could tell you story after story about that. You know, for our young people who grow up in a Wi-Fi connected world, a world of very, very quick information, and a world where the nature of authority has changed. You know, when you guys were kids, when I was a kid, we had recognized paths of authority. Teachers were authorities. Parents were authorities. In fact, the vicar at the front of church was an authority when it came to spiritual things. Now Google is the authority. And you know, if you go to church with young people, they will sit there and they'll Google what the vicar is saying at the front to check that what he said is true, in inverted commas. So the world of authority has changed for our young people. I mean, I could go on and on and on, but that's what I do, and that's what I talk about. So thank you for having me. You're probably thinking, oh dear, why have we got him here this morning? And to be honest, you are going to get a bit of that from this talk. You're going to get an insight into what goes on in here. And for those of you that know me, you probably think that's just Wonder Woman and McDonald's, which is probably pretty true, but I won't mention much about them. But if you are new here today, I recognise some of you, I don't recognise others. If you're new, you're more than welcome. And understand that I know that church can feel pretty strange sometimes. As I said, you know, when I first went to church, I'd never been to church until I turned up as a teenager, and I got it all wrong all the time. I was standing up when everyone else was sitting down. I was sitting down when everyone else was standing up. The vicar at the front, when the offering went round, this actually happened, he said, the offering is for the poor people who live in our parish. So I took money out as it came round. Because I took him at his word. I was like, well, I haven't got any money. So I took a load out. You know, this genuinely happened. I got bored and so I let a stink bomb off in the service once. And it got so bad that they had to abandon the service halfway through. Now, those of you who are used to church, you know how serious it's got to get for them to abandon church halfway through. But the church loved me into the kingdom. And they didn't understand me. They didn't get me. It was a very upper middle class church. But they just kept loving me. So never underestimate the power of a loving church, really, honestly. They just loved me into the kingdom. Anyway, I don't know for you, what are the most beautiful words you ever hear? It could be, I suppose, I love you. I'm trying not to look at anyone because that would just be weird, right? I love you. It could be, I love you. Maybe if you're a parent, a mum at home, maybe the words, honey, I'm home, is just like water to the soul so you can hand the kids over to your husband or whatever. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe it's a favourite line from a favourite book or a favourite movie, a poem. Maybe it's a few words that would mean nothing to anyone else, but for you, they convey a whole host of meaning. Maybe it's the words, remember the clocks go back tonight, and you're like, yes, an hour extra sleep. But for those of you with parents, I feel for you, because kids have no concept, do they, of an extra hour in bed. So, but what a relief it is to go, do you know what? We get an extra hour in bed. I don't know if any of you remembered. Did any of you forget? You were all there. You were all sorted. You're allowed to nod or shake your head, right? You were there. And confession time. This talk really is based about what went on in my head and as I considered this concept of an hour's lay-in and stuff. And it might seem a little bit random as a subject and as we delve into the Bible in a moment. But normally what happens when you go to a church, you're given a subject to speak on or a passage to speak on or a series. But delightfully this morning I said, speak on whatever you feel led. So it's your fault. Yeah, speak on whatever you feel led. Now, I have to confess, I always struggle a little bit with that because what it's meant to mean is you're meant to pray and seek God as to what passage you're meant to speak on. But whenever I do that, my mind really gets distracted and I start thinking about McDonald's or Wonder Woman. So, so this is as a result of thinking, well, what does it mean to have this extra hour? I mean, we don't actually gain an hour, do we? I mean, all we're doing is changing the clocks. We don't gain anything at all, really. And the truth is, we don't even manually change most of our clocks, do we? Because they're all done electronically. I'm, you know, some sort of signal that goes out to Greenwich somewhere, I guess, and it bounces back and changes everything, apart from the clocks on our ovens and the car, which just seem to stay an hour wrong for 6 months, don't they? And then it all works itself out in 6 months, so it's all right. Or maybe that's just me. Is that just me? No, it's a few of you. That's good. But when you start thinking about time, time itself is a really, really weird thing. It's something that holds us. It's something that controls us in many respects. It's this measurement of non-stop consistent change, normally from a specific viewpoint. And the concept of time is not something we're taught, but it becomes sort of self-evident and almost intuitive, doesn't it? This steady passing of events before our eyes, the orbit of the moon around the planet. But you try describing time in much more detail than that, and you get yourselves in knots pretty quickly. Even our physicists have real trouble trying to explain what time actually is. And believe it or not, crazily, and I don't understand how, apparently gravity actually curves both space and time. I don't understand it, don't ask me to explain it, but apparently it does. The stronger gravity is, the more space and time actually changes. I mean, my mind's blown quite at that point. And apparently, if you expose yourself, as humans being, if you expose yourself to new experiences and new environments, it does actually make time seem to move slower for us. There is something that happens in our brain that helps time to, in effect, feel as if it's going slower. So those of us that are a little bit older, if we try new things, it does seem to slow down the passage of time. Now, you're probably sitting there thinking, Matt, you've been speaking 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and you haven't even mentioned God yet. Don't worry, we're coming to God. Because you see, where does God fit into all of that? You see, on the one hand, we can talk of God as timeless, meaning, I think, that he's not constrained or bound by time in the way that we are. I think that's what we mean by timeless. He's not limited by time, but at the same point, God is intimately interacting every day, every second, within time, especially when it comes to us and our lives. In fact, the Bible talks, it says that there's, and I pray for you guys at the back trying to follow my talk as it comes up on the screen, but the Bible does say that there seems to be a time for everything. It says that in the book of Ecclesiastes, written by this guy, King Solomon, who actually had everything that one could want. At that point, he was the richest guy on the planet, and he had a harem full of women. He had everything he could want, and he still said, meaningless, meaningless, everything is meaningless. But in his book, he says, look, there seems to be a time for everything, even a time for those things that we would struggle with, like war and hate. The Bible does say there seems to be a time for even those things. But don't worry, we're not delving into this passage. The Bible talks about a kairos time, which is time movement, as we understand time, but also talks about a kairos time, a moment of God's perfect appointed time. Sorry, I think I said kairos both times. Chronos time, as we understand it, and kairos time, this God's appointed moment sort of time. And then my brain started thinking, well, when did time itself start? And we go right back to the very beginning. What I think are some of the most beautiful words I've ever heard. Right at the very beginning of the Bible, the first words ever said, in the beginning, God created. Beginning, that's time. I mean, what was there before time? And how can you even create something when there's nothing to create it into? How can you create space and matter when there's nothing to put into? I mean, again, it begins to blow your mind. And it's really interesting when you start reading the Bible, you start understanding this creator God is intimately involved with time. Note that when God creates at the beginning of Genesis, he creates in a really special way. It's a strange word that's originally used. It's a word ex nihilo, which means out of nothing. When God created at the beginning of time, he created out of nothing. It wasn't that he got this big box of Lego and tips it out and then made something out of Lego. He didn't make the earth out of stuff that was already there. No, he created out of nothing, which again begins to blow our mind. And in fact, a little bit later on, when it says he created mankind or humankind, it uses the same word, he creates. When he talks, let us make man in our image. I hope you notice that. There's a plurality there. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit in our image and our likeness. It says, let us make. When they're talking, it's make. But when they actually do it, they create. And there's a difference. They created humankind out of nothing. We are special and we are unique in the creative order. Now, of course, some of you are sitting there thinking, well, the moment you mention creation and the moment you mention Genesis, you know, you fall into the same pattern that we all do, we all have since about 1950, where we think creation versus evolution. The world pushes us into two camps. You either have to believe in a creative being of some form, or you believe that you're a product of freak almost mathematically impossible chance, process upon process upon process upon process. And the world forces us into those two camps. In fact, there's a couple of quotes coming up on the screen. We don't have to read them all, but kind of just shows a bit of what I mean. I think they're coming up. This first one is from a theologian. He's a great guy called Robert Capon. He is a theologian and a food critic. That sounds like the kind of job I want, right? And he starts talking about a creative God in a quite sort of strange, esoteric way. Perhaps if we move on to the next slide, from the beginning of the book of John, this sort of creative urge of the Godhead. But there's the opposite view, which again will come up, where it seems to be that we have to believe in a sort of a mathematically impossible, but nonetheless, I guess they believe that happened, sort of creation. Now, it won't surprise you to hear that I stand firmly on the side of a creator. And we can debate how that happened. We can debate that over a glass of wine, which God also created. We can debate that, you know, how long it took and all of that. But for me, it's just as much a step of faith to believe in a creator God as it to believe in chance process after chance process. I personally don't have enough faith to be an atheist when it comes to creation. And in fact, two physicists that I quite like to read that's coming up here, at least they acknowledge the problem. Paul Davis, you know, he talks about the fact that the truth is the impossibility that our universe would be able to sustain any form of life without extraordinary complex fine-tuning. And I think there's a second one that will come up too. But you see, I don't think the problem is a scientific one. Because the deeper truth is this. If you acknowledge there must be a creator, the next question is, well, what does that creator want of me? And that's the question that most people don't like to listen to or answer. You see, if there's a creator, we have to ask the question, what does that creator want of me? And that answer may infringe on my rights or my liberty or my morals or my ethics or my relationships or my life decisions. So a lot of the world just covers its ears and refuses to ask the question. Perhaps the most important question humankind can ask is there a person, capital P, behind the universe or not? And Genesis itself is a strange kind of writing. It's not easy to understand at times. Sometimes it's written in a purely historical sense. Sometimes it's written almost in a poetry kind of sense. Doesn't mean it's not true. It's just a different way of understanding writing. Sometimes it's written as if it were God above looking down and trying to describe what's happening. And sometimes it's written as mankind looking up, trying to explain what's happening. Perhaps the best explanation is imagine you're a family and you've gone out camping and the sky is clear and bright and you're around the campfire and you've had your hot dogs and your s'mores and you're quite comfortable and then your little kid says, Daddy, how was the earth made? Perhaps your answer might begin, well, son, on the first day. You see, perhaps the Genesis explanation is much more of an explanation like that of a father trying to explain to his children what happened. And then, of course, the Bible moves on really quickly because it wants to. Chapters 2 and 3 of Genesis move quickly to the creation of you and I. Because we are the pinnacle of God's creation, unbelievably. I mean, look at the person next to you. Sometimes it's hard to believe we are the pinnacle of God's creation. But the Bible says we are. And it moves quickly into that, which kind of goes a bit to explain why the order of creation is different in Genesis 1 than in Genesis 2. Because it's rushing to point us to something. You see, I think Genesis is written for a specific question. Genesis is written to answer the why question, not the how question. If we use Genesis as a how scientific textbook, we may get ourselves tied up in knots. But if we use it as the why question, answer to the why question, it fills the answer nicely. Incidentally, if atheistic scientists try and answer the why question from a how standpoint, they get themselves tied up in knots too. But I kind of rest on this verse from Hebrews that, you know, if God is good enough to place my faith in my life's course, my eternal salvation, then he's good enough to trust for the creation of the world. And Genesis sort of tells us that there is a person behind creation and that that person is knowable and is known. And that there's value to creation and that creator and creation deserves a response. But, and I'm moving to the point of the talk really this morning. But of course it doesn't stop at Genesis chapter 2. If it did, it would be lovely. But it moves into Genesis chapter 3. You see, Genesis chapter 1 is, and this is a long word, but I'll explain it, is about God's transcendence. That just means his aboveness. Genesis 1 is about God's aboveness, his majesty, his awe, his wow. Genesis 2 is about his immanence, which means his there-ness. And spoiler alert, transcendence and immanence come together in the person of Jesus. God's aboveness and his there-ness come together in who Jesus is. And if you want to understand God a bit more, delve into who Jesus is. But at the beginning, mankind is depicted as perfect. And you know, when we are the best version of ourselves, we're good. The person sitting next to you, the person you live with, the person you drove here with this morning, the best version of them is good. And it talks, the Bible talks about this relationship with God where he's walking in the garden with us. And we're involved in the work of the Godhead. We're naming the animals and all is good and all is right and all is holy. And then this disconnect happens. And again, you know that just by the person sitting next to you, don't you? Where there's a relational break, where something happens, where something's said or they do something and it's, ugh! And this relational disconnect happened between mankind and God. And between mankind and creation, actually. And we can delve into a little bit more detail. But it depicts it in a sort of a bit of pictorial form. It, you know, most of you will know this story. It talks about a garden, and it talks about a snake, and it talks about Adam as man and Eve as woman. Actually, it's interesting, the New Testament, the rest of the Bible, the later bit of the Bible, assumes all of that is true. Even if you're not quite there yet, even if you can't quite picture that and believe that, know that the truth of the story is this, that the disconnect happened, that the break in relationship happened. And in our hearts, we know that could be true, don't we? You know, the reason I believe in a literal fall is that I see it at work in my life all the time. We blame the woman for eating the fruit from the tree. Typical woman. But I know I'd have taken the fruit and probably first because it's food. And maybe that's the first lesson for us, actually. The first lesson we can learn is that the creation story isn't history. It's sort of lived out. I think it's going to come up. It's lived out in our lives day by day. Maybe it's not. Don't worry. And biblically, you know, in churches we call this the doctrine of the fall. But that just means the beliefs we hold about what happened. I don't think fall is a very good word, if I'm honest. The Bible sort of adds it in as a title. But a fall sort of implies a bit of a trip, doesn't it? Fall implies a stumble, a mistake. It's much deeper than that, isn't it? The Youth Bible actually calls it the beginning of sin, which I think is quite a good title. I think it should be called The Rebellion, but then it sounds like a Star Wars movie, doesn't it? But that's what it's not a mistake, it's not an accident, It wasn't something Eve did because she, you know, no. This was a deep, deep, deliberate break of relationship. You know, the Bible doesn't call our sin mistakes, doesn't call it slip-ups, doesn't excuse it because, oh, I was a bit tired, or, oh, the kids were noisy today, or, oh, I was hungry, or, oh, I didn't want to hurt their feelings, so I. It just calls it out, calls it sin, this rebellion against what God has said. And I'm just going to race through this chapter 3, really, in about the next 5 minutes or so. And it talks of this snake, which actually was part of God's creation. Somehow this was still part of God's plan. God is still in control here. But this snake is evil personified. And later in the Bible, it describes it, gives it a name, Satan. And the first thing that the snake does, that Satan does, is slander God. He says, did God really say you must not eat of any tree in the garden? Well, no, God didn't say that, actually. He didn't say don't eat from any tree in the garden. In fact, he said the opposite. He said, you may eat from any tree in the garden, except. And often in our lives, we can end up doing the same, sort of twisting and adding to God's word. In fact, the woman, the Bible says, she said, oh yeah, God said, you must not eat of it, you must not even touch it. God never said that. And how often do we do the same? Do we sort of add to God's word? Especially in church. The number of times I go into churches and we've sort of made some unofficial rules that have to take place. To me, that sounds a bit like the Pharisees. The Pharisees, the Old Testament keepers of the law, sorry, New Testament keepers of the law, they added all these rules for behavior, 600 extra rules for behavior. And the more rules you add, the more God sounds like a tyrant. And God is never pictured as a tyrant. He's never pictured as a remote judge looking down on us, telling us off. Interestingly, again, this is a little bit deep for a Sunday morning, perhaps. But when Satan talks of God, he uses this name of God, which is Elohim, which actually is a valid name for God in the Bible. It's the name given to the supreme God, the awe-inspiring God, the God that would make you want to fall on your knees. But until that moment, God had never called himself that. He called himself Yahweh Elohim, which means the creator God come near. It's interesting that Satan's first move was to try and separate us from God again. And don't put your hands up here, but how many of us feel that inside? We feel separate from God. You're probably sitting there thinking, Matt, if you know what I've done in my life, the things I've said, the things I've thought, you'd want to be as far from me as possible. The truth is, if you knew what went on in here and what went on in here, you wouldn't be inviting me to preach. And I suspect the same is true for all of you before you get too cocky. You know, we think we're so bad we have to be separate from God, but God says no. You know, perhaps that's the next lesson. Is that too often we push God away because we feel inadequate and unworthy. But the more inadequate and unworthy you feel, the more God wants to reach down and grab hold of your hand. The temptation to push God away is strong, but he's stronger still. And in fact, Satan goes on to talk. He says, oh, you can touch it, you won't die. Actually, he kind of had a point. They wouldn't physically die, but spiritually inside they died. And there are lots of us walking around, physically we're fine, but inside spiritually, something has died. You know, just going on, time's running on. You know, the tree was beautiful. The fruit was pleasing to the eye. No wonder it tempted. You know, sin is always tempting, isn't it? I mean, if it wasn't tempting, we wouldn't do it. Sin is always so tempting. And she took and she ate. And the downfall of mankind happened. But I love those words. I mean, where else have you heard those words before? Take and eat. If you've been in and part of church for any length of time, we say it most Sundays when we take communion. Take and eat. And I love the fact that communion somehow redeems what happened back in the Garden of Eden. Take and eat. God says, in partaking with Jesus, I come close to you once again. The Bible actually says that they realized they were naked and they tried to sew fig leaves to cover themselves, which is sort of a bit ridiculous. But the first sacrifice actually happened when God gave them skins and clothes. And God was separate from mankind again. And the Bible then moves on to say in chapter 3 that God was walking in the garden and couldn't find them. Now, of course, he knew where they were, but he called out to them, "Where are you?" And they were trying to hide. And I think there's lots of us here who try and hide from God because we just feel unworthy and inadequate. We refuse to listen when he calls, but he's going to keep reaching out and he's going to keep calling. And God gave them the opportunity to confess what they'd done, which I think is really important. And somehow there's a power in us confessing what we've done. In fact, many churches spend time in their services confessing what they've done. And isn't it funny? The woman, those of you that are parents, you'll know exactly this. The woman, the first thing she does is she says, "It's not my fault. It's the snake's." She says, "It's the snake's fault. Oh, and by the way, God, you put the snake in the garden. So by inference, it's your fault, really." And Adam, he goes, "Not my fault. It was her fault." You know, the first sign of guilt in anyone's kids, I work as a youth worker, I know this. The first sign of guilt is that they try and get as many other people involved as possible. Isn't that true? That's true. And we do the same. "Oh, it's not my fault. It's your fault, God. It's the snake's fault. It's Adam's fault. It's Eve's fault. It's my husband's fault. It's my wife's fault. It was the other driver's fault. It was the bank's fault. It was the supermarket's fault," you know? We have to be honest and face up to the fact that sin is our fault. And we take responsibility for our choices and our decisions. And the Bible moves on to say that not only was there this enmity, this disconnect between mankind and God, actually there was a disconnect between man and woman. This moment caused this enmity, this can't live with them but can't live without them sort of mentality to happen between man and woman. And then there's just this one phrase that says, "But one of her descendants will crush the snake's head." This future picture of Jesus destroying Satan and his work. And as we begin to end in the last few verses of chapter 3, in God's mercy, I think, he curses the ground. He doesn't curse mankind, he curses the ground. Work isn't the curse, but the ground is cursed. And he gives Eve a name for the first time. Up to this point, she's just woman. But she's given a name at this point, Shavah, which sounds in Hebrew very similar to Shayah. Shayah means alive. And she's given the name alive, where at this point she probably feels, she's never felt more dead than this moment. And paradise is lost to mankind. And an angel pushes them out of this Garden of Eden to work the land. And the angel is guarding the way back. In fact, it's a powerful angel. The same angel actually carved on the Ark of the Covenant in the Old Testament. The same angel carved in the, or embroidered in the curtains that guarded the Holy of Holies in the temple. But one day that access will be given. And as I close, back at the very beginning of Genesis 1, there were two trees. We only seem to talk about the one, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and all that I've just said. But there were two trees, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. And up until that point, man was free to eat from the tree of life. And actually, them being kicked out of Eden was an immense act of graciousness on God's part, because no longer could they have access to the tree of life. I imagine being able to live forever but be stuck in your sin. Wow. And as I end, to end a bit more positively, the rest of the Bible, right, pick it up if you've got it, or on an app on your phone, the rest of the Bible, after chapter 3, the whole of the rest of the Bible, right, is one big story of how God fights to bring us back to himself. The whole of the rest of it is how God is working in time to bring mankind back to himself. All of the stories that you learned at Sunday school, everything, the big picture is that he's fighting to bring us back to himself. And so the final lesson we learn is that the fall is not the end. God, acting in love and grace and sacrifice, brings us to himself. Eden is restored, and we can one day walk with him. And it says this in Revelation, I think, which will come up at the end. The very end of Revelation, where it's saying, one day there'll be no more tears, no more crying, no more shame, no more hurt. Eden will be back. And then it says, and the tree, we can once again eat from the tree of life. Eden will be restored, and one day we will walk again with him in the garden, spending eternity time forever with him. And in case you're wondering, that is how I spent my hour this morning, thinking about all of that as I came to preach to you today. So thanks for listening. Thank you for coming to be with us in church this morning. And I hope, thank you for hearing from God as he speaks into your heart today. Amen.
Thank you for that, Matt. Huge amount in there. And if you're kind of struggling with some of the concepts in that, some of the things that were said, see Matt afterwards. I'm sure he'll be happy to explain it away. Or we're doing an alpha course at the moment, which is basically just a chance to explore some of these concepts, some of the questions that kind of Matt's maybe raised. But I think he ended right with the key thing, in that through all this, after the end of this, God has been constantly fighting to bring man back. And that's the good news. That is the good news, that God didn't just let go, that he's fighting for every one of us to bring us back into that relationship. We're going to close with a couple of songs this morning. So, Michelle, if you'd join us. Would you like to stand and we'll sing together?
Good, I will ever nearer.
'cause I want to see you, feel you, know you more, 'cause I want to see you, feel you, know you more, 'cause I want to see
Fantastic. We've got one more song for this morning before we close. I'm going to ask Mickey if he can help us. We're going to take up an offering. The bucket's going to go round. Just to repeat what Matt said for those who are not sure, it's for things to go in, not to go out. If you are desperate for money, come and see us afterwards. We'll be good. We've been in those situations before where we've ended up with less money than we started with. Fabulous. As the bucket comes round, if you're kind of visitor, you're not prepared to give, that's absolutely fine. This is something that we do as a church for the church and the community. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. That you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that
what you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Fabulous. Do take your seats. Our service has come to an end. Just a few kind of important notices for you. Right at the start, when Matt was introducing himself and telling about what he did, one of the things he said is to reach the next generation, we've got to change how we do it. And we're desperately trying to work through how to do that. So next Sunday, sorry, I'm flipping on one there, Ron, but next Sunday, we've got our Sunday fun day service. We've had a few of these now. And it's about us, and it's about the kids as well. And it's a very much a dual thing. This is not just for children. It's as much for the adults as the younger ones. But it's geared up to food and games and such as that as well as a talk. Can I just encourage you to come along? If it's just the kids that comes along, it's a very different kind of church to kind of what we're aiming at. So I encourage you to come along, join in. I think next week might be quite wet in here. But you know, not everybody will get wet, just certain people. That'd be great. So to flip back one, tomorrow we are... apparently, according to Facebook now, we are well known for being the hot dog church. That suits me, yeah. So I think we're going for a record tomorrow of maybe 150 hot dogs we're going to give out. If you can help in any way, that'll be fantastic. If not, if you can pray for hot dogs somehow. Just pray that kind of the interaction with our community on Halloween will be... we'll just look good. We're literally just out to serve our community and say, we're not that weird. We just want to bless you with hot dogs and hot chocolate with marshmallows and squirty cream. Is there any? I think there might be another. Yeah. Karen doesn't know this, but Karen is the clipboard king. Karen stood at the back. If you don't know Karen, we're going to have a shared lunch on the 20th. If you want to sign up for that, be great. Anything to do with food, Matt's got to be good, hasn't it? Absolutely. We're all on the same page. Is that it, Ron? Is there one more? Early notice just for your diaries. Not sure when yet, but it'll be on the 11th of December at some point. It will either be 10:45 or like 6:30 or 6:45 in the morning. Not decided yet. That's us for this week. Thank you for so much for being with us. If it is your first time or your first time for a long time, don't go without saying hello. I'll try and grab you. Seriously, if you've got any questions from the talk, there was a lot in there. We'd love to talk it through with you as well, or Matt would. Hang around, chat with folks, and hopefully we'll see you next week. Be great. Have a blessed week. Thank you.